Hey guys, Nando here. I wanted to take a moment before the start of the show and have you like and subscribe to our channel. If you're watching us on YouTube, click the subscribe button and ring the bell to keep up with the latest videos and catch show releases early. Leave us a comment and let us know what you think of the show. If you're watching us on Facebook, please like and share the page and don't forget to leave a comment there as well.
What are you doing?
I'm giving them a moment to subscribe to all of our pages.
Oh. How long is a moment?
You know, like, a moment.
Okay, moment's up.
No, wait, it's not.
Jerry, roll the episode.
Don't forget to subscribe!
Welcome filmmakers, fans, and friends to Indie Cinema Showcase, your number one source for filmmaking, conventions, and everything in between. I'm Christina Carmona.
And I'm Nanda Louise Rowe. Together we'll be bringing you the best and brightest that Florida has to offer.
In today's episode, we'll be speaking with actress, singer, music educator, and filmmaker Cheryl Carbonell, and we'll be checking out her docu-series trailer, The Power of Creativity.
We'll also revisit some of our past events and then hang out with Tim Anderson as he lets us know which films we should see before we die.
All right, let's get things started with our feature docu-series trailer, The Power of Creativity, directed by Cheryl Carbonell and Molly E. Smith.
When we dig deep and we really heal the inner parts of ourselves that are maybe holding us back, we can find a purpose.
It's almost like therapy, I guess I could say. It's really helped me feel better about myself. It's helped me get a lot of things out of my head, get a lot of things off my chest.
So I always wanted to be somebody where little girls who look like me could look up and be like, I can do that too.
I think I struggled through the years, and when I started to paint, I found a lot more peace.
It's a therapy in a way, but it's also using that pain into turning it into something good, you know?
Once I started to figure out how to paint, I just feel like the floodgates open.
Our next guest is a Canadian-born and raised entertainer. Her parents, who were Jamaican, made sure she maintained her Caribbean culture. After moving to the States and surviving the culture shock, she dove into theater with the Orlando Opera Company, and her journey continues into filmmaking. So for today's Industry Insight, we sit down with Cheryl Carbonell. Hey guys, in the studio today, we have Cheryl Carbonell with us, actress and singer. Cheryl, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
It's nice having you here.
It's a pleasure. So, what got you started in the industry?
Well, a long time ago when I was 12 years old, my kindergarten teacher, who I'd had, she was nurturing my musical talents in my school, in my hometown, Windsor, Ontario, Canada. And she said that this company, Windsor Light Opera, was going to be doing Annie, and they wanted a bunch of girls to come and audition. So I was like, yeah, I'm going to audition for this. And I did, and I had to sing in front of the whole company and the parents and all the moms that brought their kids and everything. And the director really liked me. And he was like, I wish you could be our Annie. Because back then, you know, no girl of color could be my Annie. Right. So I was cast as the Orphan July, and I had a blast. And that was their only show that I think the company had been in existence for like 80 years or something like that. It was the only show that they brought back again the next year. So they brought us all back. I think only one or two people had to leave, but all my little friends were, you know, my little orphan friends. And we had a blast. And I just knew from then on that I wanted to sing and act And that was it. Now, I didn't necessarily fall into it right away, but that was the seed that was like settled into the ground, and I packed it up and I knew it was going to grow.
I think you always know, like even from an early age, you always know that you're meant to be in the entertainment field. Like you feel it right inside here.
Yeah. Yeah. I loved singing solos from my school, and I was always picked me and this other girl, and I loved that. And then it grew into performing. So,
right.
Yeah. Now, we know that you perform with Orlando Opera Company.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that. And how did you make the move from Ontario, Canada to Orlando, Florida?
Well, my parents are Jamaican. Right. And so they actually there's this thing called the Windrush generation, where all these English colonized countries, mm-hmm. England was rebuilding from the war. So they asked in a effort of like an apology, mm-hmm. they asked the countries that they had colonized, can you come back to England and help us rebuild, and in exchange we'll give you jobs and whatnot. So my parents were part of that generation. They were like 18 and 19, and they all got on a boat. It's called the Windrush generation. And you know what? The Small Axe series, if you've ever heard that, it kind of goes into detail about that. So my parents met and married in England. They decided it was too cold. So my dad moved to Windsor, Ontario, Canada. Go figure. But he was the first electrical engineer in to work at Chrysler Canada in Windsor. So then they decided it was too cold again. They saved up all their money, and they said, we want to live near Jamaica, where we're from. So we're going to move to Florida, where we had vacationed.
Right.
And then eventually they bought a condo in Jamaica, and they went back and forth. So nice. I was too young to stay in Canada at the time. I wanted to stay.
Right.
But I was too young, and they moved me down to Florida, and I was glad that they did, because I don't think I would be where I am today. So Orlando Opera Company, I went to UCF, and my professor brought a bunch of us who were graduating over to Orlando Opera Company as college students to be a part of the company. And that was my first paid, like they paid us and everything. It was my first paid gig with in a professional environment. And it was amazing. Like, they brought Denise Graves. I don't know if you know who Cheryl Milnes is, but in the opera world, these are like the big stars that they brought down from the Met Opera to headline the whole thing. And then we filled out the rest of the cast. It was amazing. It was so much fun. And from there, I grew into a principal role. So that was a lot of fun too.
I mean, like that, one of the things, like you can always imagine, it's like, you know, it's like, what? You want to pay me to do something that I love? You want me to pay me to sing and perform? Absolutely.
No, I know. Nah, I'm cool. Dressing up in those costumes, I mean, it was elaborate and it was so much fun. And it was really freeing because at first I was part of the ensemble. And so I didn't have any lines. The pressure was off.
Right.
And it was just wonderful watching the bigger stars, the known names, let's say that, the known names process and working with directors. And I really didn't understand upstage, downstage or anything.
Right.
I just did it and had fun. I jumped into acting classes here in Orlando at ArtSake. And then
We've mentioned this, like it seems this season we've had
a lot of ArtSake,
including ourselves.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah.
We had a lot of ArtSake folks come through the studio this year.
Yeah, we chose right.
We chose, yeah.
Yeah, you did. No, I love it. It's conversation. Don't let me dominate.
We know that you know, you're doing the acting, but you also do production as well.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about your production company.
Okay, well, that's to speak of it evolving. So my production company actually started just solely as a voice and piano studio. And I had a business, and I had opened and closed businesses so many times because as a woman, I can only speak from my perspective, having children and going through all their phases, I've had to pivot and change what I do, but try to still keep it in line with what I love and who and stay true to who I am. So I opened and closed these businesses. And this last time I opened one, I was like, I'm not going to close it, even if I don't know what I'm doing with it, mm-hmm. even if it pivots, you don't have to close it, like just let it grow. So it started as voice and piano. And when COVID hit, I did not want to teach virtually. I did a little bit, but it just, it's not the same. So I'm actually going to start my first, face-to-face visit tomorrow. So I noticed around me at the gym, I don't know why at the gym and beyond the gym, other women, you know, doing the same thing, like figuring out, you know, they've raised their kids. Some of them divorced, and their identities completely gone, some of them. Mm-hmm. Some of them having their degrees, like I have a master's degree, another woman had a doctorate degree, but she wasn't using her degree right. because she had raised five kids and then her husband, you know, left her or whatever. And then I saw her resilience though. She had turned to painting. She started a business. She'd always had a gift for painting and she was painting her butt off and selling them and making a living right. from doing that. And I said, I'm gonna dig into the lives of these women and I'm gonna make a documentary. It's simple. It's a simple, it's not people that climbed that Everest in a day and lived.
But it's a real story nonetheless.
But it's a real story and it is mm-hmm. profound and people want to hear it.
Right.
And I wanted to make these stories accessible to everyone. I hoped that kids would watch it and men would watch it. I didn't know if they would, but they did. So far it's some of the films that I've, I don't know if I answered your question. Did I answer your question?
Okay. Yeah.
There are five mini documentaries in the series. Uh-huh. And some of them have screened in Orlando. And I had a group of people come and they were teenage boys with their girlfriends. And afterwards, like it really hit them. Like, and I know they did because they quoted things from the film. Like I'd never, like one of the women in my films was very candid. And she said, I found that I couldn't have children and my marriage failed, she said. And she's deciding to live a life of celibacy. And she's not dating. She's putting all her creative energy into her business and her painting. And I thought, you know, teenage kids would laugh or think that's weird, but they really like thought about it.
Right.
You know, and the fact that this woman said in front of them that she couldn't have children, like it hit them.
Right.
And that's what I wanted. I wanted people to look around them and see that, you know, people around them every day have stories, deep yeah. stories.
Right.
And they find ways to triumph. And in this particular case, it's painting that delivered mm-hmm. these women.
I love that. And I feel like, you know, some people are always looking for inspiration and you try to grasp at things and it's like, I can't figure out. I'm like, your neighbor, your yes. own life, you know, you can find inspiration. You were at the gym.
Yes.
You know, there's stuff all around us that tell a story. And I think the greatest thing about filmmaking and art in general is that we get to tell a story.
Yeah.
Someone else's, our own,
yeah.
and being able to give that to other people. I think
that's some of the best stories, like you were saying, it's not even the narratives, like it's not even the fictional stories, it's mm-hmm. some of the real life mm-hmm. story, because that's what people connect to.
Yeah.
You know, so having folks coming in and seeing the lives of these women, they understand that that person on the screen isn't an actor. Like right. they're telling their true story. And right. a lot of people can connect to that and see themselves in those people on the
that's
screen
right.
as well.
And
you said it way better than me.
No, stop it. You're fantastic. But it's a funny thing because there's so many people in this world, but yet we always, as individuals, think that we're the only ones that are going through something.
I know.
Like, you know what I mean? So it mm-hmm. always helps to hear that maybe somebody else feels the same way, kind of like your podcast.
Yeah.
So let us know where we can find more about your film, your work.
Okay. All right. Well, to find out more about me, I've got a website, Cheryl with an S, Sharyl, Carbonell, Carbonell. So CherylCarbonell.com. I'm also on Instagram at CherylDrCarbonell. And about my films, I've got an Instagram dedicated to my business. It's evolving and changing. So it's called Creativology Music and Film. And I also photograph wrestlers as a hobby. I know that's so, oh, we didn't talk about that.
We need to talk about yeah, that.
Yeah, yeah. I photograph wrestlers as a hobby because my kids wrestle and I love it. And that tells a story too. And if you're interested in that for some reason, it's called Creativology Photography. Thanks for having me.
If you would like to be a guest, have something to promote, or have your film featured on the show, visit us at our website at indiecinemashowcase.com. Watch past episodes and help support the show by buying some of the merch at our online stores.
Follow us on our socials, Facebook at ICSTV and on Instagram at ICSTVShow. You can also reach out to us by emailing us at ICSTV@yahoo.com.
Hi, I'm Cheryl Carbonell. You're watching Indie Cinema Showcase.
Welcome back, but we are ready to go on location with ICS. In this episode, we visit AEO Studios and speak with owner Alan Ostrander.
Hey guys, I'm here at AEO Studios with Alan Ostrander. Alan, thank you for joining us today. So tell me a little bit about yourself and what got you into the industry.
Well, I've been doing theater, makeup, special effects pretty much all my life. I started on stage as a performer when I was 10. And through the years, I've run the gamut of doing a little bit of everything from theater, film, television, both in front of the camera and behind. But my biggest love is special effects and makeup and creating movie magic.
Now, was this something that you were always like passionate about, or did something trigger you to be like, hey, that's what I want to be doing?
I was never actually a big horror aficionado. Most of my background is in stage, in musical theater, and that's what I really enjoy most. But the majority of our work and what we do is all blood and guts and gore. I've been designing haunted attractions for many years and actually got the moniker of Hong Kong's father of Halloween for my 13 years working over in Hong Kong, developing Halloween as a holiday there.
So tell me, what are some of the companies that you've actually worked for?
All over. I've done a lot with all the theme parks, Disney, Universal. I was a designer with Cirque du Soleil for a while in Hong Kong. Ocean Park down in Argentina, designed several attractions there. In Orlando, one of the things I'm most known for was the attraction Terror on Church Street, which was one of the first year-round full haunted attractions. And I was the makeup and character designer there for our 8-year run here in Orlando.
Now, aside from horror, what are some of the other things that your company actually does?
We do all types of theater. We supply all the local theaters with their prosthetics, their makeup. We are the largest producer of Ogre appliances, which can be used for Shrek the Musical. We just hit 600 productions a few months ago that we've outfitted over the years on that. We also do a lot with private companies, all types of medical appliances. In a couple weeks, we're making silicone puppy feeders for puppies that have no mother. So it's a very wide range. We do a little bit of everything.
So we have a lot of local filmmakers in the area. Can you explain to us what the process is to have AEO Studios be a part of somebody's film?
Sure. It is an interesting process when we work with different film companies. The biggest thing is getting in contact with us first. And what we're gonna do is we'll go through the script, start doing a full breakdown of what the director is thinking. And most of the time, those tend to be fairly outlandish and may not be possible. But that's the part that I love because it's our job as effects artists. We'll go through all their ideas, all their script, and come back and say, well, this is what is doable, how we can achieve that effect. Like we actually have, this guy is going out to tomorrow for a video shoot for a horror film and needs to get disemboweled. Every effect, every film is different, and it's a lot of puzzle solving and problem solving.
You also mentioned about teaching students. How do they get involved with that?
Well, again, first step is getting in touch with us. We do have classes here at the studio almost every weekend, and we post those schedules on our websites. We do very small classes. I only have 3 to 4 students at a time, so everything is very hands-on. I love teaching and paying it forward, trying to keep the craft alive, because it's difficult to learn a lot of this. So we do all types of one-day workshops. And we have everyone from 10-year-olds just wanting to play with makeup to seasoned makeup artists that want to get more into special effects. I have a lot of actual film producers or directors that will come take a class as well so that they understand more of the process when they are filming. It's very important that we all know at least a little bit of what each other's job is. We just open it up for anyone. We have our advanced classes where we get more into actually making life casts and molding up our students, which is quite a process. And this is normally the first step in fabricating prosthetics and effects that we'll use for the film. And this poor girl's gonna get her head chopped off in a couple months.
So if people want to find out a little bit more information about the company, where can they go to?
Please visit our website at aeostudios.com. You can also stalk us on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter. Everything is AEO Studios. Please check us out, or if you're in the area, come by the shop. We do a lot of classes. One of the things that I really love is being able to pay it forward and keep the craft alive. So please contact us, anything we can do to help and make you a monster.
Well, there you go, guys. If you guys want to check out AEO Studios, be sure to follow them on their socials, as well as stop on by for a visit. You'll be surprised as to so many cool things that are in here right now. Thank you again for joining us. It's been a pleasure.
Not a problem, sir. Thank you.
It was so much fun getting to sit and become a creature of the night.
Listen, anytime you get into a role, you get all method, and I end up on the bloody end of the deal.
But did you die?
I'm just going to take that opportunity to just segue to the Enzion Theater, where Tim Anderson is waiting for us to let us know which films we should see before we die.
Hey everybody, how's it going? I am Tim Anderson. I am Program Coordinator for Enzion Theater and the Florida Film Festival. And these are films to see before you die. This film I want to talk about today is a movie that I doubt a lot of people have seen, and I consider that sort of to be an absolute atrocity. And the film is 1975's Cooley High, directed by Michael Schultz. Cooley High is American International Pictures, Roger Corman, Sam Arkoff's company's answer to American Graffiti, Universal Studios movie directed by George Lucas. Pretty much one of the most famous coming-of-age teen movies of all time. And 1975's Cooley High, which is often considered to be the Black American Graffiti, and the two films definitely share a lot of DNA. American Graffiti, set in 1972, Modesto, California, and Cooley High, set in 1964 in Chicago, Illinois. Basically, both films are about a group of teenagers just out of high school who are moving forward to the next big thing in their lives. The soundtracks are wall-to-wall. American Graffiti's being sort of classic 1950s pre-British invasion film songs, and sort of a heavy, heavy R&B Motown soundtrack inside of Cooley High as well. And it's one night, it's the misadventures of a group of teens. But the thing about Cooley High is that when I watch American Graffiti now, it feels like it takes place in 1962. It is a nostalgic film that has an ending that makes you remember maybe what would be considered a simpler time. Cooley High is so alive. It is so in the moment. Its issues are so current that it could have been made yesterday. And what I think is interesting about this film is to see how it has inspired other films. Lots of people will tell you that things like American Graffiti begat things as simple as Fast Times at Ridgemont High, all the way down to Dazed and Confused or American Pie. Cooley High is the genesis of Boys in the Hood. It is the genesis of Menace to Society, of so much what you would consider quote-unquote urban cinema today, movies that are talking about African-American experience. And the fact that it is set in 1964, you know, in a time of racial upheaval in America, is not lost on the movie, but it is not what the movie is about. What it is about is these inner city kids who have the exact same kind of hopes and dreams and stupid things that they're going to do as all of these kids that are happening in American Graffiti. It's an inspiring film to kind of take a look at if you're a certain kind of a filmmaker who's really only been exposed to specific kinds of movies, and to understand universal truths that exist across the spectrum of humanity, but can also be utilized in cinema so that you can identify, I can identify, and you can identify with the characters that take place in a movie that is, you know, 55 years old, 60 years old, and is not where I grew up. I did not grow up in inner city Chicago, but yet I cry so much when this movie is over. It's an incredible film, it's a beautiful film. If you're a Boyz II Men fan, it's how the album, Coolie High Harmony, got its name. And the closing song is It's So Hard to Say Goodbye to Yesterday, so if you're super into 90s R&B, you'll figure out where that song actually came from. It was written for the movie. I love it. I think you should see it before you die, and I hope you don't die. Thanks again, everybody, for joining me. I had a great time with it. I hope you love the movies. I'm Tim Anderson, Christina, Nando, back to you.
Well, that's all the time we have for this episode of ICS. We want to thank Cheryl Carbonell for sitting down with us, Alan Ostrander from AEO Studios, and Tim Anderson for those great movie suggestions.
We hope you learned something new, saw something that you love, or got inspired to get off your couch and go make a movie of your own. Who knows? It might be good enough for us to screen on the next Indie Cinema Showcase.
Don't forget to follow us on our socials, Facebook at ICS TV, Instagram at ICS TV Show, and YouTube at Indie Cinema Showcase.
And if you want a chance to have your work, event, convention, or film festival featured on ICS, send us an email at icstv@yahoo.com.
Until then, the set is closed, and as they say in the movie business, that's a wrap.
See you next time.